So now what happens in the network is at each time step, a new block is created that validates all the transactions in that block. At the point where this block is created, this has to be the longest blockchain. That's the way that Bob can validate that this was a valid spend. Someone could try to create an alternate blockchain. So if Bob wants to spend the coin twice, what Bob would need to do is create a chain that's longer than the longest chain. When a transaction is validated by the network, all the signatures in the coin are checked. This is using the transfer chain. But to prevent double spending, there's also a check of this chain of blocks. And the check is the longest chain is the one that's viewed as correct. So each peer in the network might see a different view of this chain of blocks. If they see different views, the one that has the longest chain is the one that will be viewed as the most correct view of all the transactions. So every participant in the network is effectively keeping track of all transactions. And the version of all transactions that people trust the most is the one with the longest chain. And if an adversary wants to create a longer chain with a different view of transactions, so if Bob wants to double spend this coin and say, give the same coin to both Kathy and Doug, what Bob would need to do is create a longer chain that convinces Doug that this is the correct view of the network and this view is incorrect. So that requires finding these hash values. If the power of the network exceeds the power of the adversary, well, then it's likely the network will have a longer chain than the adversary can produce. And keep in mind, the motivation for producing this attack is just to be able to double spend one coin. There's still the chain of public key signatures that validates the transfers of each coin. So the resources that you would need to spend to produce a longer chain to convince someone that you didn't spend that coin in the other chain, which is now the one that would have included the previous spend, is to find these hash values quicker than the network can. The incentives are set up in such a way to make it unlikely that someone will want to do that, since if you do find the next hash value in the chain, well, you can create a new block, which is worth 50 Bitcoins. If you create a longer chain, trying to catch up to the chain that the network has, well, that's going to require a lot more computing resources and would only allow you to respend the Bitcoins that you already owned. So this doesn't provide anonymity in the traditional sense. It avoids the need for a central authority, but each transaction is known to everyone in the network. The way to provide some anonymity is instead of using your actual names in the transactions, you can have different identities for each transaction. So this is going to be some new identity. It will still need to have a certificate that validates the public key for that, but it doesn't need to be tied to Alice's identity in any way that's visible to anyone else. So that's the way to provide some anonymity, even though all the transactions in the network are public to everyone who participates. So this actually works. There's at least a reasonable number of people that trust this currency and are providing computation to create these blocks, which is incentivized by creating the value of new Bitcoins. There's about 9 million Bitcoins currently available, and the market price fluctuates, and it depends on the cost of computation as well as the trust in the Bitcoin network. There have been some incidents where the price fluctuated wildly because there was some concern about the security of the Bitcoin transaction site. But the current market is fairly stable, around $5 for a Bitcoin.